Lonnie Bunch, it's so good to see you here.
It's my pleasure to have you with me.
It must be a capstone.
It's one of the most humbling and exciting moments of my entire life.
On this journey you have been to get to this point with this museum, what has been the biggest surprise for you along the way?
I think I've been stunned by the excitement and the way people really care. I mean, there are times I'll walk in an airport and people will just sort of give me the thumbs up, or I'll walk down the street and church ladies will come to me and say they're praying for me. So I think the fact that this means so much to so many people has been the biggest surprise for me.
Now, when you say that it means so much to so many people, you're not just talking about famous people or people in the museum?
I'm talking about people on the street who just walk up to me. I don't know who they are. They're not famous. This morning I was walking in and a woman stopped me and just said, "I know who you are. Thank you." That's the kind of thing I didn't expect, and that's been so humbling about this process.
What do you think that thanks is rooted in? Is it a sense that a story wasn't told?
I think it's a couple things. I think, first of all, it's the acknowledgement that being on the National Mall in some ways says this story is important, is legitimate. But also the fact that on the National Mall means a lot of people will see this story. So it's not just a black story, that a lot of visitors will see it. And I think there's excitement about that. And I think that the realization is that once you have this museum on the Mall, it's going to be there as long as there's an America.
A lot of people think of black history as black history, not as American history. Was it important for you to be on the Mall in order to counter that notion?
It was really important to be on the Mall because in some ways, one of the great joys of the Smithsonian is people come to the Smithsonian and wrestle with issues, subjects that they won't in their own home. You know, they'll come to natural history even if they don't like natural history. So what I wanted was the recognition that there would be millions of people who get to explore African-American culture that they won't do in Chicago or Los Angeles or Dallas. I think for me, it really was an opportunity to say, this is not simply a story by black people for black people, that in essence, this was the quintessential American story, that if you wanted to understand who we are as Americans, our notions of resiliency and optimism and our sense of liberty and our changing notions of citizenship, where better to look than this community? So for me, this is all of our story.
But in this country, we are so nervous about talking about race, about engaging. We keep having national conversations about race, and it seems that this building itself is a big conversation. Did you encounter along the way any resistance to the notion that we talk about Americans only by race?
I think there was fear that we would be a place that might be divisive, that people wouldn't want to talk about race and that we would force them to talk about race. I think there was a great concern that would this just be a museum by black people for black people? And I think we had to counter that both by the kind of stories we told, by the way we tried to say, this is a story of America through an African-American lens.
And one of the most important parts of that is who gave to this museum, not just artifacts like we see here. We're surrounded in the sports gallery by Wilma Rudolph and Muhammad Ali and everyone.
Pretty cool.
It's amazing.
Huh?
It's extremely cool. But you're also talking about people who wrote small checks and big checks, many of them African Americans, without necessarily the resources you would expect.
One of the things that I'm proudest of is that we have 100,000 people who have signed up as members, overwhelmingly African American. $25, $100, because they realized something that I learned very early in my career, that the African American community wanted a sense of ownership. And by being members, by getting a little plastic card, they get a sense of making something real. They get a sense of ownership. And that, to me, means so much. And what I really love, candidly, is that we were able to find a lot of resources within our community that people didn't know about, whether it's support from churches who don't normally give to cultural institutions, or the fraternities and sororities that have said, we want to give large sums of money to make this work. For me, it means that we've been able to prove that African Americans are an amazing source of philanthropy that'll change the way the Smithsonian and other cultural institutions do their work in the future.
We are at an interesting crossroads in our country. And you can define it by the violence and the disputes with police. You can define it by what we expect of our children and education and employment. You can define it by the imminent exit of the first black president. How amazing that this facility is opening now.
Well, I am so pleased that we're able to do this while President Obama's in office. It was one of the few promises I actually made, and that in some ways, no one would have known that we'd be at this moment, that there would be renewed attention to black-white friction, to renewed attention to black police relationships. Candidly, in this political environment, there are issues of race that continue to divide us. This museum, my hope is, can basically be a kind of great convener, a safe space that contextualizes the issues that we wrestle with, that give people tools to live their lives. It is really exciting, but it's also a heavy responsibility, because our job is not to create just a museum, but to create a place that maybe through dialogue, through exhibitions, can make America better.
When Michelle Obama at the Democratic Convention mentioned that she wakes up every day in a home that was built by slaves, that resonated with a lot of people. Here we sit in a facility that was designed by black designers, built in part by black contractors, financed by black financiers. Is that also a mirror image of where we are?
Well, I think, first of all, it's important to realize that while there was a lot of black support, there was a lot of non-African-American support. In some ways, for me, this is a hopeful museum, and that a variety of people said, regardless of race, this is an important story that must be told. But I think it's also important to realize that there is powerful support, resource in the African-American community, and for the fact that they came together to do this is really one of the most powerful things I think has happened during this process.
As this is coming together and you stroll from exhibit to exhibit and gallery to gallery, taking note of the 3D conceptualization of everything you've seen on paper, what takes you aback still after all this time? What do you look and go, oh, look at that?
Well, first of all, just that it's actually done. I mean, I spent hours looking at drawings, working with the curators, working with designers, and seeing it on paper, and then suddenly seeing that it's real. I think I am taken aback by, candidly, what an amazing group of colleagues I have who are able to take sort of an idea and make it real. I watched people, as I walked through the galleries, installing major artifacts, doing it with speed and care. So I'm really taken by that we're at this moment.
So when you see Harriet Tubman's shawl, or when you see, I don't know, any item, a pair of shoes from Shaq, does that pull you up short and say, when did we get that?
Most of the time, I'm pretty aware where we got it. But I'm always struck when I turn a corner and I'll see a costume from Lena Horne. I didn't know we had that. Or I will see Althea Gibson's jacket. I'll think, what a great story this is. I'm so glad we have it. So I sort of walk through this place and discover new things every day.
Are you at all surprised at the incredible rush of interest in the opening? The minute you put tickets on sale, they were gone. You put some more on sale, they were gone.
I just got a report that we had 5,000 tickets that went in 18 minutes this morning. So I am stunned by the way the public has gotten excited about this. I'm pleased, I'm humbled, but I'm stunned. I didn't expect there to be that kind of interest. Clearly, as you said earlier, it's the time we're in. It's people worrying about, well, the president will be out of office soon. What does that mean for African Americans? But I'm so grateful that people get to see this work that so many people spent years to make real.
On a mall, which is full of white buildings, except maybe the Smithsonian Castle, you have a crown. You have almost a New Orleans-type fretwork on the exterior. When it first went up, I have to say, I thought, what are they doing? And then when it was lit, and I thought, oh, I get this. That was on purpose, wasn't it?
Yes. Maybe because I came back from Chicago, where architecture is so key to everything, that I wanted to do a building that would be signature, that would be distinctive. But then I realized that if we could take this corona and really take those images or those designs that enslaved craft people did of the ironwork in Charleston and New Orleans, what we were really saying is, on the one hand, we were paying homage to those folks. But we were also, as Michelle Obama said, we were also saying so much of our history is hidden in plain sight. And we wanted to encourage people just to look, to realize how the built environment has been shaped by the African-American community, the political environment has, and the cultural environment has.
Is it fair to say that for the first few weeks, there will be a lot of black faces in line to come into this museum, but over the long term, would you be happier to see a broader mixture?
Well, we expect this to be one of the most diversely visited places in America. When we did a lot of our surveys early on, 75% of white Americans said this is a story they want to know as well. So we think being part of the Smithsonian, telling a story that is in the news now about race in America, I think that this will be a place, I hope, that a diversity of Americans come and call home.
And I want to ask you, go back one moment to the idea of change. What happens in the future? What you see here today that won't be here tomorrow, other things will be. How much of a living museum will this be?
I think this museum has to be as much about today and tomorrow's as about yesterday. So part of the job is to collect current affairs. So we collect Black Lives Matter. We look at, you know, what are contemporary artists doing so that sometimes we will use them. Other times we want to make sure that, unlike early in my career, when there were stories I wanted to tell and I would look in collections, there was nothing there. I want to make sure that curators 50 years from now can tell the story of today if that's what they want to tell. So I hope this museum will continue to evolve, continue to change, because it really has to be a place that is the great convener, that can bring anybody and everybody into a conversation around race. And that conversation should change over time. And hopefully a future director will be smarter than I am and come up with better ideas.
Lonnie Bunch, thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you.